Southern blue whiting is a small member of the cod family. It's typically grows to 30 to 55, maybe 60 centimetres at the biggest. So it's a bit like a shape, a bit like a mackerel, but they tend to be a little bit skinnier. And the fishery itself was first developed in the 1970s by the Soviet fleet at that stage. They took catches up to 50,000 tonnes or so. And then with the declaration of the New Zealand EEZ in 1979, they then developed joint venture arrangements with New Zealand companies. And that continued through until about 1992, I think it was. At that stage, they bought in quotas or catch limits for the first time for the fishery. They were set at around 30,000 tonnes. And that continued on until I think early 2000, when it entered the quota monitoring system and became a quota species, like orange ruffy and hoki and the other species, important commercial species in New Zealand. So the fishery itself is a trawl fishery, and it's based on spawning aggregations of fish. So every August and September, the southern blue whiting spawn in four main areas around the subantarctic region. The main fishery is around the Campbell Islands, and the second main fishery is around the Bounty Platform, and then the smaller fisheries on the Pukaki Rise and around the Auckland Island Shelf. The fish are very highly aggregated to spawn, and at that time they make a very good acoustic target. And what happens is that a beam of sound is sent down from the vessel, usually goes down to the bottom and then comes back up, and it tells the vessel skipper how deep the water is. And now if you've got fish in the middle of the water column, it'll hit the fish and come back up to the surface again. Then you can have a way of monitoring the abundance or numbers of those fish in the water column. Now the fishery itself is very clean, which means there's very, very little bycatch, maybe 1% or 2% of other species such as hoki and hakenling. But 99% of the catch is usually southern blue whiting, and which once again makes an ideal candidate for acoustics surveying. So the main monitoring tool then is acoustic surveys, which we carry out routinely using our research vessel, the Tangaroa. We carry out biennial surveys on the Campbell Island Rise area, covering an area of about 30,000 square kilometres with each survey. Once we've got the acoustic survey data, we also combine that then with the commercial catch information, so the catch history that's taken from the fishery over a period of time, and then also the age composition of the catch, and that's calculated by using ear bones from the fish, which we use to age the fish, and then we have observers which measure fish at sea as well. So we use those two bits of information, the acoustics data combined with the catch data and the age composition data. We put it into a population model, and we use that to estimate abundance and then estimate yields from the stock. So the assessments we have in place suggest that the fishery is being sustainably managed. One of the most interesting parts of southern blue whiting is the very high recruitment variability. In southern blue whiting, if you get a strong year class, then the population can increase almost tenfold from one year to the next as that year class comes into the fishery. So we don't know exactly what causes that year class, the recruitment variability. It might be something to do with the weather conditions, the climate, the temperature, or other factors. We don't yet know why it is that it happens, but when it does happen, it has a profound effect on the stock size. And so, for example, when we first started the surveys in 1993, the adult stock had been fished quite hard. It was around 30,000 tonnes. 2 years later, when we went back and repeated the acoustic survey, the population had increased to 150,000 tonnes. So this was just the effect of one strong year class going into the fishery. And that strong year class persisted over the next 10 years and enabled the fishery to be sustainably managed over that period of time, during which the population declined back down to around the 50 to 60,000 tonne mark. So the fishery itself is dependent on strong year classes. When they come into the fishery, the TACs increase to take account of that increased production, as the populations fish down, then the TAC and the catch limits typically follow that trend downwards until another strong year class comes in. So I think you can say it's sustainably managed, the fishery, but the catch limits will vary from year to year based on the recruitment variability of the stock. The impacts of the southern blue whiting fishery are believed to be relatively small on the ecosystem. The fishery itself is relatively clean. Almost 99% of the catch is southern blue whiting. Very small amounts of other bycatch, fish bycatch species. Also, the juveniles tend to be in slightly shallower water than the adults, so it's primarily they're catching adult fish rather than juvenile fish. The trawl gear itself is predominantly midwater trawl. If they do go onto the bottom, then they tend to touch the bottom fairly lightly because the gear itself is fairly delicate. So it's not quite the same as having a bottom trawl with large bobbins sort of rolling along over the seabed. You know, it's a sort of a skimming of the ground gear on the seabed. So the benthic impacts are probably quite small as well. There is some bycatch of marine mammals and probably also seabirds in the fishery. So the main impact on the bounty platform would be the catch of the New Zealand fur seal. And I think up to 100 fur seals may be caught each year in the bounty platform fishery. And that's out of a population of around 15,000. So in terms of the impact on the population, it's probably not excessive, but it is significant still. The other major concern is around the Campbell Island fishery, there is some bycatch of the hooker sea lions, and the hooker sea lion is more endangered within New Zealand waters than the fur seal. So that is a potential concern. However, at the moment, the numbers of individuals caught is the order of one or two per year. So it's not a large number of fish, of seals being caught, but there is some impact on those populations potentially. I guess in summary, in many respects, you know, the southern blue whiting is one of the best fisheries within the New Zealand EEZ. You know, there's a clean fishery. We have a good assessment. We have a good monitoring tool. There don't appear to be any major impact on the ecosystem. Very little effects on the bottom fishing and other bycatch species. So, for southern blue whiting, it seems to be reasonably well sorted.